Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Grace, peace, and all. In the name of Christ our Lord. He calls us to this time of worship to continue our Lenten journey. Journey with one another to the cross of Christ. And there we see again the depth of God's love for us all. It's a joy to share with you in this time of worship. Welcome to all. Just a reminder of the registration pass that helps us know of your participation in this time of worship. And I also look for you other opportunities, especially in this Lenten season. The midweek services each Wednesday at noon that are held here have been wonderful times of worship for all who participated. So I invite you again. We have three of those services remaining. This coming Wednesday, Bill Dobbin, our pastor who's serving a couple of churches in the Danville district at this time, will be leading worship for us Wednesday at noon. Also a reminder of the Lenten study from the Gospel of John each Wednesday evening at 5:30. I do give attention to other opportunities as they are before us, especially as we anticipate Palm Sunday and Holy Week and have significant times of worship there. We see before us the representation of the prodigal son. As we share from the Bible this morning, we can share from the Gospel of Luke, 15th chapter, speaking of the way in which God reaches out to reconcile us to himself, and that artwork anticipates that time of worship for us. I invite us to prayer and worship God together.
Thank you.
hearing, I call the word. Come, let us celebrate the forgiving, reconciling love of God.
During the season of life, we experience some times of trial. Remember the temptation of Jesus. Remember the sadness of Jesus as the people reject him. Remember that despite our faith in Jesus, we still know what it is like to suffer. Still, in the midst of the long days we have in this season, God comes to us as a God who is with us, not only in darkness, but as a God who also rejoices with us. This is so because God is always looking for us, and God ultimately finds us. Having found us, God rejoices in the most joyous of ways. God celebrates finding the lost and inviting me to share in his joy celebration.
Like a widow finding a lost coin. Like a shepherd finding a lost sheep. Like a father finding a lost child. God celebrates finding each of us who is lost. Such is the love of God for us that his joy in finding us knows no limits. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that you seek us and take us. We pray that we would share in the joy you feel at finding the lost. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
We'll invite our children to the event as we share in our children's time.
Thank you.
16th chapter, verses 1 and 2, and then 11 through 32. Hear the word of God. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." He said there was a man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of property that falls to me." And he divided his living between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took his journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in loose living. And when he had spent everything, a great famine arose in that country, and he began to be in want. So he went and joined himself with one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have fed on the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. When he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, that I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.'" And he arose and came to his father. While he was yet at a distance, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and make merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found," and they began to make merry. Now his elder son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what this meant. And he said to him, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has received it safe and sound." He was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, "Lo, these many years I have served you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you never gave me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your living with harlots, you killed for him the fatted calf." He said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to make merry and be glad. For this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." This is the word of our Lord. Well, allow me to ask for a show of hands here. Who among us is the second-born child in our respective families? All right. Well, those of you who have raised your hands may be interested in an article I recently found online, an article from Southern Living, an article titled, "Second-born children are more likely to be rebellious according to science." The article begins by telling us, "Second-born children have long been believed to be the troublemakers in the family, and now there's scientific evidence to back up that theory." According to a study by MIT economist Joseph Doyle, second-born children are indeed more likely to exhibit rebellious behavior, and that goes double for second-born boys. I find the results to be remarkable, that the second-born children, compared to their older siblings, are much more likely to end up in prison, much more likely to get suspended in school, enter juvenile delinquency, Doyle told NPR. To come to this conclusion, Doyle analyzed data sets from families in both Denmark and the state of Florida. I guess those, who knows? And as he wrote, despite the large differences in geographic area and environments, the findings were remarkably consistent results. In families with two or more children, second-born boys are on the order of 20 to 40% more likely to be disciplined in school and enter the juvenile criminal justice system, compared to first-born boys, even when we compare siblings. The data allows to examine a range of potential mechanisms, and the evidence rules out differences in health and birth and the quality of schools chosen for children. So there. According to no less an authority than Southern Living, we have scientific proof as to why rebellious second children are in fact rebellious second children. But we really don't need that esteemed academic journal, Southern Living, to verify what we have long suspected to be true, do we? Now it's true, there are times we need Southern Living if we're going to make a red velvet cake, or decorate the living room, or trim the hydrangeas, then we need Southern Living. But we don't need the Southern Living to tell us about rebellious second children. We've got the Bible to do that. Yes, we have the Bible to tell us of those rebellious second children. For it's the Bible that tells us of Abel, the younger brother, the favored one of God, and about Cain, the older brother, so envious, so bitter, that he has to dispatch his younger brother in the field. It's the Bible telling us of Ishmael, the older son of Abraham, and how older brother is resentful and vengeful against the second child, Isaac, and all his descendants. It's the Bible telling us that the older son of Isaac, Esau, despises the younger brother, Jacob, that mischievous, rebellious, usurping cheat, who through his cleverness and conniving ways stole a blessing and birthright due to the older brother. And it's the Bible telling us that even Joseph, the youngest son of Jacob, serves as something of a second child to all those older brothers. And we remember that Joseph was so curried in the favor of his father so as to invite the wrath of these older brothers who faked Joseph's death, peddled him off to Egypt. And it's in the Bible we find this story we share from the Gospel of Luke. A story told by Jesus. A story I suspect we've heard. This story about the father who had two sons, the younger and older. A story of great family drama. Drama presented in basic matter-of-fact form. A man had two sons, the younger of these sons, the rebellious second child, remember. Ask Dad for his share of the inheritance. Dad complies with the request of this son. In fact, he divides his living between both sons. And in a few days, the second child gathers all his stuff, heads off to a far country, throws it all away. Terrible famine arises in this country, and the younger son is in lack of all necessities, joins himself to a citizen of that country, a citizen who sends him in the field to feed the pigs. So desperate is the plight of this young man, he wishes he could even eat the seed pods upon which these pigs feed, and he comes to himself, decides to return to Dad, confesses unworthiness, asks simply to be treated as a hired servant. On his way home, Dad sees him from a distance. Stirred by compassion, Dad runs to him, hugs him, kisses him. The younger son humbly confesses, but Dad calls to the servants, bring the best robe for him, put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet, kill the fatted calf, we're going to blow the roof off this place. Now this younger son, remember, has an older brother. You know, the older, obedient, play-by-the-rules child. And of course, while Dad and younger brother and everyone else is partying, older brother is working diligently in the field. Drawing near the house, he hears the music, dancing, asks one of the servants, what gives? refusing to have anything to do with this. And Dad comes outside asking to join the party, and older son replies, "I've served you, never disobeyed you, but when this wasteful and disobedient son of yours comes back, treat him like a king." Dad says, "All I have is yours, and it's right to celebrate, for this brother was dead and he's alive. He was lost and he's found." Quite the drama. Father raising two sons, the younger of the sons wanting to leave home to start life new, live on his own, and older son dutifully tending to chores at home while the younger son, according to him, wastes his father's living with harlots. The younger son, having wasted all, comes to his senses and returns home. He's got no other choice. He wants to save himself. So the second son, who has acted immaturely, impulsively, sees he has no choice but to return home, where he will receive the punishment due him, right? Isn't that what should take place? It's true. There are few stories we love more than this. But it's understandable. If we wonder why it is, we have such affection for this story. Because there is something offensive here, isn't there? It's an offense that we may try to resolve by editing the story. What I mean here is that we may decide to stop with our reading of this parable before we get to the end. And that occurs quite often, this decision to stop reading this parable at the point where the younger son returns, and with the father's declaration that it's time to throw those extravagant celebrations. And we understand why we might want to stop there. It seems to be an appropriate ending place, and it appears to be they all lived happily ever after moment. Dad says the son was dead, is alive, was lost, he's found, it's time to party. End of story. And no doubt many who preach on this parable decide to stop right there. To do so provides a happy ending, and to stop at that point also does this. It prevents us from having to deal with the fury of the older son. But we notice, given the option of stopping at this place of celebration, Jesus does not end his parable there. Because remember, the man has two sons. We've got to deal with this reaction of the older brother. A reaction in which this older brother makes clear he doesn't believe the celebration upon the return of this younger brother is right. In fact, as the parable concludes, we see the brother as one who's angry, and we're not told he accepts the invitation of the father to attend the party thrown for the little brother. Sure, we're inclined to fuss at the older brother for his attitude toward this celebration. But would any of us suggest that the older brother doesn't have a valid point? We understand. The young man returns having blown everything. A response of party and celebration hardly seems fitting. To respond in such a way as this, doesn't it seem like we're condoning this behavior? To throw a party upon the return of one who behaved as this young man behaved? How is he ever going to learn? Should there not be consequences for his behavior? Throw a party, what kind of message does that send? Taking offense at the grace shown by the father upon the return of the younger son, we understand. But could it be? This is a story not about the prodigal son, but a story about the prodigal father. Could it be this is a story about a father who takes the greatest of delight in rejoicing at a child who was lost, but is now found? You know, we are given three opportunities to get this point. Jesus first tells us about a shepherd who, having lost one sheep, leaves the other 99 to find that lost one. I'm going to risk losing these 99 sheep to find the one that's lost. And having found the sheep, he calls friends and neighbors to celebrate. Then Jesus tells us about a woman having lost a coin. Is not content simply because, well, I've got 9 other coins. She lights a lamp, sweeps the house until she finds her lost coin. But she's not content just to have found it. She's going to call friends and neighbors and rejoice at having found that which was lost. Now Jesus tells us about a father who finds a son who's lost. Again, the finding of the lost calls for the most extravagant celebration. Understand the older brother. But a closer look at the story tells us that when Dad gave the inheritance to the younger brother, he did the same to the older brother. And we also see that Dad goes out to ask him into the party. You're welcome here. This is your party too. But as the parable concludes, we don't know if the older son ever joins the celebration. Well, regardless the order of our earth, there's nothing we can do to change the nature of our Father. He withholds nothing from any of his children, and he will seek until he finds. He will even take great risk to find the lost, and he will lose no one. Then when he finds us, most extravagant of celebrations. So we're invited to share the most gracious of celebrations by the most gracious of hosts who makes room for us all, the one who gives to each of his children everything he has. Will we share in that celebration? Respond to the word by affirming our faith in the words of Scripture from Romans 8. I invite us to stand and share the word. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. such is your love for us, that you withhold nothing from us, not even your own Son. We thank you for this opportunity to worship and serve you through our giving, and pray that this turned into your care accomplish as much for the gospel of Christ. Amen.
Forgive us, Lord, when we can be resentful or bitter.
because of your grace shown others. Work within us by your Spirit, touch our hearts, so that we may realize we have all been lost, we have all gone into far countries, we wasted what you have entrusted to us. But you are a God who will not let us go, and you are a God who rejoices in finding all who are lost, even us. Lord, in your mercy, hear us, Lord, as we pray for the people of this congregation. Lord, in your mercy, hear us, Lord, as we pray for concerns of this community. Lord, give you mercy. Lord, give you mercy. Hear us, Lord, as we pray for your world, its peoples, and its leaders. Lord, give you mercy. Thank you.